after my dad died, I realized that there was a big space in my life, so I started going to the Florida Native Plant Society in Tallahassee, I live in Tallahassee. And I started going on a lot of field trips. Can everybody give it? And I started going on a lot of field trips, and I started buying field guides and going through them and saying, oh, I've seen that, oh, what's that, you know, and so I'm all taught from going on field trips with people and looking in books, and I think it was about 2013 or 2014 that the Tallahassee Magnolia Chapter of the Native Plant Society had Dr. Doug Tallamy come to speak. And I've since have seen him three more times, once at the Georgia Exotic Pest Plant Conference, once at the Regional Exotic Pest Plant Conference, and then just this last January or early February in Panama City at the Florida Wildflower Panhandle Alliance, Florida Panhandle Wildflower Alliance. So the second time that I heard him speak, I was with the person who had invited him, Karen Rollins, who was our here as invasive species coordinator with the University of Georgia here in Tifton, but she's not able to be with us today. And so I was out to dinner with him, and I said, well, you can't be everywhere. Do you let other people have your slideshows to present to people? And he said, yes. So he mailed me a slideshow. And then this last time that I saw him this year, he did a somewhat different presentation, probably about 50% of it was different, and I asked him, would he send me a slideshow again? And he said, yes. So I've spent the last week or so integrating the old slideshow with the new slideshow and emphasizing the ideas that he's emphasizing now. And so that's what we have today. Are we getting a good dark picture now? Okay, great. Can everybody hear now? Okay. So Dr. Tallamy teaches at the University of Delaware. He's an entomologist, meaning he studies insects. And I want you to look at that picture very carefully and see what that mama bird has in her mouth. And also while I'm thinking about it, pull out your pink sheets if you would please, because I'm going to refer to those when you want to look at them. Some words in the slideshow. So we all love the beauty of the natural world. This is Gulfwood Larry, one of our more common butterflies in this area on a milkweed plant. And to save nature, we must become a part of nature. That's a fabulous butterfly. I've only seen it twice myself, once at Greenwood Plantation and once someplace else. It's the zebra swallowtail. We also have a zebra longwing. Isn't it gorgeous? Oh my goodness. Its host plant is the pawpaw, and I've planted 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, or 6 pawpaw trees in various locations, hoping that one day they'll find our bird. But that's part of the thing with butterfly garden. There have to be butterflies around to lay eggs. So our goals today are to talk about why we need biodiversity, that we need to change our landscaping paradigms to save biodiversity, why animal diversity depends on native plants, and how to make our landscapes sustainable. In the United States, and this is an old slide from 2013, so probably more now, we've paved 4 million miles of roads in the United States. We've converted 62,500 square miles to suburban lawn, over 8 times the size of New Jersey, dedicated to a non-native plant. 41% of our land is in agriculture, 54% is in cities and suburbs. So where does animal diversity come from? The whole lecture, the whole talk, the whole shebang is about native plants, and this is a beautiful native forest with canopies. We all know that plants are the only organisms that some people say can eat sunlight to make it into food. They take sunlight and the carbon dioxide that we put out into the air and water to make food and oxygen. So obviously we cannot survive without plants. For all of these reasons. So how did we come to have a beautiful animal, a megafauna that we like a jaguar? Jaguars almost primary food are peccaries, this kind of little wild pig. This is in Central and South America. Peccaries almost exclusively eat this kind of date. So if you don't have a date palm, left in your ecosystem, you will not have any jaguars. So this specialization in the natural world, especially food specialization, is the rule rather than the exception. Specialization always starts with plants, and as we'll find out, native plants. So here you have a beautiful gathering of phlox, which has a very deep throat, so it depends on insects with long proboscises to pollinate it. As you can see, it's long enough to go down into that deep throat of that flower. And so the insect depends on the flower for its nectar, and the plant depends on the insect for its pollination. You don't have the plants, you don't have the insects, you don't have the insects, you don't have the plants. And this is true, this is our native, does the arrow show up on the screen? Oh, okay, good. This is our native honeysuckle. The white honeysuckle is a bad invasive, but this one is really beautiful. And you see it has a very deep throat, and so it requires animals, mostly hummingbirds, to pollinate it. Again, the bird needs the plant needs the bird. Specialized relationships. So what does it take to have chickadees? Carolina chickadee feeds its young almost exclusively caterpillars. In fact, most birds rear their young on caterpillars. Why caterpillars? The baby birds cannot eat the seeds and the fruit that so many of the adults can. So why caterpillars? It could be because they're beautiful. And he's an entomologist, and I had to take out an awful lot of pictures of beautiful caterpillars to make this slide show less than 2 or 3 hours long. Definitely beautiful and interesting and odd in some cases. It could be because they have cool names. Green marble. Once charred, punky. Confused wood grain. Cynical brown cat. The neighbor. And he didn't tell us the name for this one, but he said it reminded him of somebody. So it's not really because they're beautiful or because they have interesting names. It's more because they're soft and juicy. Caterpillars are soft and juicy, so they can feed them to their bird, baby birds, and it provides them with their moisture, the water that they need, as well as all the nutrients that they need. Caterpillars are soft, high in protein, high in lipids, and the best source of carotenoids for birds. We get all of our carotenoids from vegetables, but a chickadee doesn't eat plants, so it has to get its carotenoids from something that does eat plants. For most birds, caterpillars are not optional. There can be no chickadees where there are not enough caterpillars. So you've got a food web there. You've got the plant that supports the caterpillar, and it's a very specific plant for different caterpillars. And then you have the caterpillar that supports the baby birds. If you don't have any of those, you don't have the baby birds. How many caterpillars does it take to make a nest of chickadees? Lots. A pair can deliver food about every 3 minutes. 30 caterpillars in 27 minutes. This is folks studied this and counted, actually counted them. That parent, did a really good job on that episode. Parents forage all day long from 6 in the morning to 8 at night. In 3 hours, in that study, they brought back 17 species of caterpillars. A chickadee pair brings 390 to 570 caterpillars to the nest per day. This study was done in 61. Chickadees feed their young for 16 days before they're fledged. Do the math. To rear one clutch, they must catch 6,000 to 9,000 caterpillars. Now, when he first did this presentation, and in the first slide show that I had, it was a smaller number, but they've done more research since and found it's even bigger than they thought. But the first time I heard him say that in Tallahassee, I went, I've got chickadee babies at my feeders. Where the heck do they get 4,000 to 6,000? It was at the time of caterpillars. Well, you're going to learn, and you see on your pink sheet, that oaks are one of the best host plants for all the caterpillars, both butterflies and moths. And I thought about my backyard, and there are a lot of oak trees and other big trees, tulip poplars and others. And I said, aha, you just don't know what's going on up in those trees. Chickadee only weighs about a third of an ounce, about the same as 4 pennies. So thinking that it takes all those caterpillars to raise the little babies, think about how much it takes to raise a red-bellied woodpecker that weighs 8 times more than a chickadee. How many caterpillars for all of these birds? Now notice too that this mama bluebird has a spider in her mouth, and that's the other main food of baby birds. Caterpillars, some other insects, small insects, and spiders. So spiders and caterpillars are essential for bird reproduction. Lots of caterpillars needed out there in the world. Birds that can eat insects, or that do eat insects, and need them for their babies, pretty much all of them. No insects, no baby birds. Now, a lot of us grew up, ooh, insects. You don't want insects in your yard. If you want life, you got to have insects. But plants don't want to be eaten. So they defend their tissues with distasteful or even toxic chemicals. So how is it that insects can eat some of those plants? Insects do eat plants. How? They specialize on only a few types of plants. You're going to hear this over and over. 90% of the insects that eat plants can develop and reproduce only on the plants with which they share an evolutionary history. So in other words, you got the plant evolving thousands, millions of years ago. You've got the insect evolving. The plant is wanting to discourage all the insects from eating it. And this insect focuses on this particular plant. Sometimes it's one species, sometimes it's several species, sometimes it's a whole genus, and sometimes it's even more than one genus. But it specializes and focuses on that plant. So as the plant evolves, the toxins and the distasteful chemicals, the insect is evolving systems in its body that can deal with those chemicals. Red cedars defend their tissues with toxins that I won't try to pronounce. But juniper hair sticks have evolved to live on red cedars. There's a butterfly group called North American Butterfly Association. You may not hear very much of that activity in Georgia, but there was very, very active groups in Florida. And I've gone on a lot of field trips with them too. And we went down to the coast one October and saw hundreds of these on the cedar trees. It was during migration. Most people know that the monarchs migrate all the way down to Mexico. Well, what I learned that day is that a lot of the butterflies migrate to the coast and they hang out on the coast. So that day we saw hundreds of these. Oh, we just saw thousands and thousands of butterflies. These were long wings and all kinds of other species. And so they go to the coast in October, and then as the weather gets cool, they don't go across the Gulf. They'll go down, say, towards Texas or South Florida, you know, to be warm enough for the winter. These are beautiful little butterflies. They're shiny green. You can't, you know, really tell just from a picture. Iridescent. Now look at this caterpillar. You can tell that it evolved with that plant because it's evolved itself to be completely camouflaged on that plant. Can you see the caterpillar in this picture? Right there. You can see the caterpillar in that picture probably. And the caterpillar in this one, it even can camouflage with the Zen leaves. So specialization can be a curse in today's world because it's where reducing the amount of native plants, the insects that are specialized on the plants have less to eat. This is a monarch caterpillar. Insects that specialize on one plant are no longer able to eat other plants. This is milkweed, one species of milkweed. We have, 20 or 30 species of native milkweeds in the state of Georgia. And that's the only plants that monarchs can eat. If you don't have monarchs, you don't have, if you don't have milkweeds, you don't have monarchs. So not long ago, the monarchs declined by over 96% compared to their populations in 1976. And there was a huge concern about that, which you may have heard about. And it had two causes. People tended to focus on the Mexico problem, where they spend their winters. And I don't know if you've seen pictures of them there in the winter. You can't even see the trees that they're roosting in for the butterflies. It was millions and millions and millions of them. And those trees only exist in certain mountain ranges west of Mexico City. And they've had a really bad problem for a long time with poachers of those trees because it's a very valuable wood. So they fought against it by arresting, they go out at night. So they went out, the loggers do. They went out at night and tried to arrest as many of them and cut it down. And then just in the last year or two, they realized that they need to close down the sawmills also that are buying that lumber. So they're doing what they can about it. But we need to accept the responsibility that a lot of this loss and a lot of this decline is because of our agricultural and roadside practices. GMOs are have been cultivated to be able to be herbicided and still live. So corn and soybeans are the ones that we have just all over the central and western United States. So where you used to have a cornfield, it would have a fair amount of milkweeds in it. Now you have nothing in that whole field but corn. And some of that herbicide goes over to the roadsides and the natural areas and kills the plants there. But then we started thinking, well, gosh, instead of mowing the roadsides, let's herbicide them. And so a lot of the milkweeds that lived on the roadsides have been killed too. And milkweeds need a fair amount of sun. So if you have woods, unless it's an upland woods like our Longleaf Pine, you know, a lot of the pollinators are going to be on the roadsides or in the other corridors. So people realize that the whole migration is becoming endangered, going extinct. There's another migration on the west coast, and that one was not in as much danger, but this one between the whole part of the eastern United States and down to Mexico was definitely in danger. And so the word went out that we needed to replant milkweeds. And there was so much done on that the population last year was significantly up from the year before that. There's an organization called Monarchs Across Georgia that has worked on that a lot. I know that the Roslyn Carter Butterfly Trail, I'm sure, is working on that. And 5 years ago, you could not find a native milkweed in a garden center or even a native nursery. But there's been a big effort to get native milkweeds into the especially the native nurseries. The reason why we didn't have any milkweed at the plant sale here today is because Dan Miller, who thought he was going to have some, we completely sold out of the native milkweeds at the Birdsong plant sale on Saturday. So they're still hard to get, but if you look you can get them. So largely due to the GMOs and herbicides, 80 to 90% of the milkweeds were gone until just recently, while there has been a movement to plant native milkweeds. Tropical milkweeds are not desirable as they interfere with the migration. And the way they do that is if all the native milkweeds die back in about September to October, and then the females know that it's time to start migrating. But if the tropical milkweeds continue to live through the fall, their homeworms don't change and they stay around and keep laying eggs and miss the migration or are late on the migration. But even more dangerous is they carry a protozoan disease that deforms and kills the monarch caterpillars in adults. There's a big effort at St. Mark's National Wildlife Refuge to grow native milkweed with Scott Davis is doing that. He's a wonderful speaker. I have a chance to hear him sometimes. And he's doing all kinds of research too. He's got more energy than all of us. And he's our upcoming president of our Native Plant Society chapter in Tallahassee. So he's doing research on which ones they use the most, which ones the monarchs use the most. And then he's distributing all the plants that they've grown. I think 1 year was 10,000, the next year was 20,000 native milkweed plants. And then they give them out to anybody who wants them, and they take them to the landowners, and they give them to the landowners. So, you know, there's a really big effort to get the native milkweeds back out. But at a work, he did an all-day workshop at St. Mark's several months ago, and I went, and there was a woman who said she had bought some tropical milkweeds that, like a couple months before that, but it was during the winter in January, and she raises the caterpillars and the butterflies, you know, in spring houses in the house, and she said most of the caterpillars were deformed, and if they survived to adulthood, the adults were deformed. So it's a very dangerous disease. It was discovered in South Florida because the tropical milkweed definitely survived all through the winter there. And so they wanted, and they started having big mortalities in the caterpillars and the butterflies, and they did the research and found out it was this protozoan disease. So if you want to keep tropicals, if you already have tropicals and you want to keep them, be sure to cut them to the ground in October or November, because if they survive through the winter, they carry that disease through the winter. And that was the word for the last couple of years, but the recent word is don't plant tropicals at all. I don't know how pivotal it is that if you cut them to the ground that disease doesn't get carried forward. But now we have options, if you look. And you can buy seeds and plants online, too. Even animals we don't think of as having specialized relationships with plants often do, like the jaguar and the chickadee. Even these insects and organisms have specialized relationships with plants. So what types of landscapes do we need that are capable of producing such insect diversity and numbers? Again, 90% of all, that means plant-eating, insects are host plant specialists. They need certain species or certain genuses, genera, of plants to reproduce. We can use the knowledge that most insects are specialists to build the landscapes that support effective food webs. So here we have a pair of wide-eyed vireos feeding their babies. And this next series of slides is going to show you the caterpillar and have the name of it, blinded sphinx, and then the tree or the plant that the blinded sphinx needs for its food. So if you don't have black cherries, you don't have blinded sphinx, and if you don't have a good variety and lots of caterpillars, you don't have baby birds. Viburnum supports this caterpillar. Sycamore supports this one. Grape supports this one. Black cherry again supports this one. Spicebush supports the spicebush swallowtail. And black cherry supports this one called the tufted bird robin moth. Of course, there are more moth species than butterfly species, and moth caterpillars are extremely important, as are butterfly caterpillars. And then there are other caterpillars too. Is it sawflies that have caterpillars? I keep wanting to learn more about that, but I don't know much about it. So you have all those different trees, we have all those different caterpillars, and then you have nice fat baby birds. So you look at this picture and you think, well, they've got a lot of shrubs and trees. I bet that's a good wildlife habitat. But then you find out that none of those trees and shrubs are from the eastern United States. So they provide no or virtually no support for the food webs. This is a maple in Dr. Talmy's yard. And here are some of the caterpillars that it supports. This is an elm in his yard. some of the caterpillars it supports. Now tell me you don't think that caterpillar evolved with that plant. Remember, 90% of the insects that eat plants can only eat the plants with which they co-evolve. True of all of these. They need specific plants. And one of the beauties of bringing nature back into your yard is you get to see all kinds of creatures you had no idea existed. These are all in his yard, all these pictures of caterpillars. But it's not just birds that need insects. The main food of spiders is insects, and other spiders which eat insects. Like I said, birds eat caterpillars, and spiders take them to their babies. The spiders eat insects, so there you've got another link in the chain. Insects eat other insects. Amphibians eat insects. Reptiles, that's our 5-month skink. If you haven't seen one of those, it's your bees. But don't let your cats get around them, because they, if the cat bites it, it has a toxin in it that makes them actually get psychotic, and they can't walk, or and they're just out of it for about 2 days. Fish eat a lot of terrestrial insects. I believe the first time he gave this presentation, he said 60% of their diet is terrestrial insects. In the larval form, like dragonflies and mayflies, all have their eggs and larvae in the water. And then I guess some of them jump up and get insects out of the air, too. And a lot of mammals eat insects. Of course, we know that bats eat a lot of insects, unless they're fruit bats. But a lot of species of bats eat a lot of insects. And all the other mammals tend to eat insects also. Isn't he a handsome fellow? Even foxes and bears, about 20% of their diet is insects. And even the raptors eat some insects, but then most of the other animals that they eat are animals that eat insects, food web. When we remove insects from any food web, it will collapse, because so many creatures depend on insects for food. Now, you know, this is not something that we've known. You know, I didn't grow up knowing this. I didn't know this until sometime in the last 10 years when I was talking about moving towards retirement. And so it kind of shakes us up to realize in our pesticiding everything and trying to get rid of insects that we're doing harm to Mother Nature. So it's a little jarring, but it's important that we accept this fact. A world without insects is a world without biological diversity, which is biodiversity, the diversity of life. We need lots and lots of different species to support lots of different species, and they're all interrelated. So here we have an article from a paper in 2009, and it says, 80 years ago, this week is National Insect Killing Week, and it is receiving support from innumerable quarters. The campaign is gaining much support for increasing the use and popularity of household insecticides, both the liquid type and powders, to boost the sales of all brands of chemicals. To rid the community of insects, several local businesses are running bargain specials on insecticides, priced at under $1 per gallon. So that was what you did, you know, back in the 20s and 30s. And then, of course, DDT came along. And man, it was just considered just the boon of mankind. I'm embarrassed to say this, but when they used to spray the DDT in my neighborhood, I would run behind the machine in the cloud of DDT. You know, we thought it was nothing but good. I've heard other people did that too, so hopefully I wasn't. I mean, I wish I wasn't the only one, but I wasn't. And of course, the pesticides get carried. If the insect doesn't get killed by the pesticide, it carries it in its body, and then the bird may get hurt by the pesticide. And as we know, our national bird, the bald eagle, almost went extinct because of DDT. The DDT from the insects got into the parent birds, and then the egg shells were weak, and the baby birds didn't hatch. So what's happening to the species that rely on insects, and this has changed more than anything else since I first heard his presentation in 2013. At the time, he said 127 species of neotropical migrants are declining, and that means the birds that migrate between North and Central and South America. This last February, 430 species of North American birds are at risk of extinction. And that comes from the State of the Birds 2016. Okay, when he first gave the presentation, he said there were 30% fewer songbirds today compared to 40 years ago. The third time I heard him give the presentation, it was 40%. And now it's 50% fewer songbirds today compared to 40 years ago. That's the age of my son. You know, in my son's lifetime, songbirds have decreased by 50%. That's pretty dramatic, and it really, really needs to get our attention. Inconvenient truth, as we might say. 33,000 species of plants and animals are imperiled and no longer able to perform their ecosystem services. 40% of the pollinators are at risk. So what is the ecosystem service? It's the plant that makes the caterpillar, that makes the bird. That's an ecosystem service, but there are lots of many others. And of course, pollinators, we all know, are pollinate from the plants that we eat and need for life. Well, why can't we just sustain biodiversity in our parks and preserves? Because we are fragmenting them. This is a woodlot on the university where he works. And when he first started doing research there, I forgot to look up the numbers, but there were something like 70 box turtles in that woodlot. But the university had recently done some clearing around it. Well, since then, they've built buildings, and they've put more ball fields and that kind of thing around it and fragmented it even more. And now, the last time they counted a year or two ago, it was down to something like 10 box turtles. When we shrink a habitat, we lose niche space. So only tiny populations can exist in tiny habitats, and tiny populations are vulnerable to extinction. So those box turtles couldn't get out and interact with other box turtles in any other woods, and the population continued to go down. This is a normal population graph for a species in an area where it has plenty of room and plenty of interaction with other of the species. There's always ups and downs. But if you have a small population size, it's very likely when you go to a down curve to go extinct in that location. The amount of life that can be supported indefinitely, and sustainably in any area is determined by the amount of native vegetation there. It's all about native plants. Sterile landscapes are starving our wildlife. In migration, birds need seeds, berries, and insects. The GMOs, herbicides, are starving the butterflies, bees, and other pollinators. Even a modest increase in native plants in suburban yards does increase the numbers and species of wildlife, including breeding birds and pollinators, including those imperiled and endangered. And that's the idea. We need to bring nature home in order to provide enough habitat for the whole circle of life. Our natural areas are not large enough to sustain nature. Not only are viable habitats fragmented, they also have been invaded by 3,300 species of introduced plants. And that's an old picture of the that now. This is Eleagnus, or he calls it Ugleagnus autumn olive. And I've seen this growing up into the trees 30 feet. You could go up and smother out trees. There's a huge hedge of it in front of Pebble Hill Plantation between Thomasville and Tallahassee. And boy, they have to cut it regularly because it's all over the place that they're in. Areas overrun with alien plants produce 22 times fewer numbers and 18 times fewer species of caterpillars, the most important insect food of birds, especially baby birds. So you got to ask yourself, can a third of an ounce chickadee forage 22 times harder, or will there be 22 times fewer birds? There will be fewer birds. This is kudzu, the first environmental plan, I think, that got a lot of people's attention. My grandmother used to live in North Mississippi, and we would travel between Thomasville and North Mississippi several times a year. And there were lots of places like this where the whole forest was covered up in cutting and killing all the trees. And of course, that was brought in by agriculture for erosion control. 85% of our invasive woody plants have escaped from the ornamental industry. We just haven't known what we're doing. We just haven't known. You know, you bring in a plant and you think, oh, it's pretty, and, you know, and it becomes stylish and everybody wants that plant. And it can take as much as 60 and 80 years for a plant to become invasive. It's like there's a tipping point where its reproduction just goes crazy, and then it starts invading natural areas and taking over our lawns and all that sort of thing. So this is, I just had so much trouble sitting on this slide, I don't know why I could not get it to do. So I'll read it to you, you probably can't read it. Invasive exotic plants outcompete and take resources from native ecosystems. I recommend you write down, I don't think I have it on the handout, bugwood.org, which is our University of Georgia Center for Invasive Species and Ecosystem Health. And that you can learn everything you need to know about Georgia invasives on that site. My friend Karen Rollins, that I told you, took me to the invasive species conferences, and got the slideshows from Dr. Tallamy. Has all kinds of wonderful literature that I was hoping we would have some today, but she's sick and we weren't able to get it. But that's something that also needs to be on your radar, invasive plants. If you have invasive plants, they'll take over your yard, and then they spread into the wooded areas. And people think, well, you know, the birds like those berries. Well, that's part of the problem, because the birds take the berries into a natural area and eat them and fertilize them and plant them, and then you've got that invasive plant in more areas. So the trees, the worst trees, and I took this out of a book from the Forest Service, I think it was, but also I'm very familiar with most of them. Mimosa, everybody loved mimosa when I was a little girl. It's a problem invasive plant. When I went to Tennessee several years ago, there was mimosa, you know, on the edges of so many of the forests. It's really become a problem. China berry, aloe tree, popcorn tree, princess tree, palolonia, Russian olive, the tree of heaven, paper and white mulberries. We do have a native mulberry, the red mulberry, which is a good fruit tree. But if you have the paper and the white mulberries, the birds, again, eat the fruit and spread the invasive species around. Camphor tree. Boy, do we have camphor tree in Thomasville. Woo! Tongolol tree, you'll see occasionally in the woods. And that, there were huge plantations of that around Tallahassee. It was an oil used for paint products. I've seen them in natural areas coming up. And there are a number of species of calorie pears, but Bradford pear is the common one here. And again, that became completely popular, and everybody had Bradford pears all over towns and down the streets and on the neighborhoods. And the awareness of invasive species was already happening when they brought the Bradford pear over, but they said, oh, it will never get invasive because it won't reproduce. But they started interacting with the other pears in the area, and now they've become invasive. A house around the corner from me was empty for several years, and it had a Bradford pear in the front yard. And the whole front yard just got full of little baby Bradford pears, hundreds of them. Vines, English ivy, all over Thomasville, going up the trees. And I've seen them smother trees. You'll see them on the trunk, and then you'll see them on the branches. And then if they get out on the leaves of the tree, it'll smother, you know, keep the plant from being able to do its food making thing. And also, I had a forester come to my yard in the last house that I owned, and he told me that English ivy makes your trees much more dangerous for wind damage because it makes them more like a sail. So if you have a great big mass of English ivy on your tree, it's more likely to get blown over. Japanese honeysuckle, I showed you the red native honeysuckle. Japanese honeysuckle was the white when I was a little girl. Oh, you just loved having Japanese honeysuckle. You'd go around and suck the nectar out of it. It tasted so good. And when I first bought that same house I'm talking about, which was in 93 or 4 or something like that, I would have Japanese honeysuckle in my garden. I thought, oh, that's so pretty. And I let it grow. Oh, my goodness. I learned to regret that. Because it, I'm going to put this down and show you. It would be like this. And then like that, and then like that, and then like that. And it got all over my yard. Oh, it was a nightmare to get rid of. Kudzu, we've already mentioned. Non-native wisterias. The house I live in now had a lot of wisteria in the back on the creek. And I mean, the vines this big. And I said to my son when I bought that house, I will be fighting that the rest of my life. Well, it's turned out not to be as bad as a lot of the other invasives, but if I don't keep at it, it does come back. Vancos or periwinkles, have a lot of that in my yard. Winter creeper, oriental bittersweet, climbing potatoes, climbing yams, chocolate vine, purple ground vetch, and porcelain beauty. I find that in my life of dealing with invasives, the shrubs are the biggest problem. I'm the lead volunteer at Wolf Creek Trout Lily Preserve, where there's tens of millions of little spring ephemeral trout lilies, a really just natural wonderland place. And the Japanese and Chinese privet were all in the floodplain. I mean, thousands and thousands, tens of thousands of the plant. And they're evergreen, so they were starting to creep up into the slope where the trout lilies are. And if that continues, they're being evergreen, they would shade out the trout lilies, because the trout lilies need the winter sun. They only live in deciduous forests where the trees lose their leaves in them, and so the sun comes in the winter. We have spent, oh my gosh, I couldn't begin to tell you how many hours of, we go at least once a month, and we have for years, probably close to 10 years, removing those invasives, predominantly out of the floodplain there, and off of the slope too, because there were a lot of them on the slope. But we pull them anywhere from this big to 60-year-old trees. We cut one and counted the rings. It was 60 years old, which makes perfect sense because that goes back to the 50s when everybody was planting ligustrum. My house where I grew up, the whole backyard was surrounded in a hedge of the big leaf, the glossy fruit, the Japanese fruit. And, you know, that's what everybody was planting in. And there's no houses around Wolf Creek, but there's a creek. And so what happens is, the seeds come out of somebody's yard and go into the waterways, whether it's in the street or whatever, and eventually end up in a creek, and then they start reproducing in the floodplains, and that's where the worst invasive problems are in natural areas. Nandana, or sacred bamboo, is a problem invasive, but not near as bad as Artesia. But Nandana killed birds. The first time that was found out was in Thomasville, Georgia. Somebody had multiple dead cedar waxwings in her yard, and she took them to the university the extension, and they took them to the lab, probably here in Tifton, and found out that they had nothing in them but Nandina berries, and that they were hemorrhaged throughout their bodies. Nandina berries are full of cyanide, and so it had killed them. And if you know cedar waxwings, you know they come in and just gorge themselves on one fruit. They have extra organs in the body to hold all the extra. And so it kills them. I don't know if it kills other birds, but I can't believe that it's doing any other birds any good. I presented that piece of information to one of the garden clubs in Thomasville, and one of the women said, oh, I feel like a murderer. Artesia is a much worse than basic plant. Its seeds are 98% viable. And I bought a house for my son and his grandmother, for him to take care of his grandmother with Alzheimer's, and the beautiful woods and the creek back behind it, and just all of Artesia. So we've been working on that once or twice a year. And if you have Artesia or Nandina, the first thing you want to do is get all the berries off, and then hopefully get rid of them otherwise. Cherokee rose is an invasive plant, and it's our Georgia State flower. And so I hope some of you garden club members will consider finding a native flower to replace that. You see that a lot in between Thomasville and Tallahassee, growing up into the trees, and they can go up and smother trees and stuff too. Beautiful flower. A lot of invasives have beautiful flowers, but it's definitely classified as an invasive threat in natural areas. the silver thorn or thorny olive, the autumn olive, the ugly agnus that I showed you a picture of a minute ago, and burning bush. Ones I have a star by are ones that I've spent countless hours of my life dealing with. Grasses, the bamboos, the fish and pole bamboos that everybody planted. Boy, if you've ever seen a stand in that, it's been let go. And I did something really stupid. I started a garden next to a stand in that one time, and I didn't know anything about it. And, you know, it came up everywhere in the garden. It sends out other grand stems that big, and they pop up. Anyway, I hope I'm not so big. It's awful. Hogan grass. Georgia did the best thing with hogan grass of anybody. There was big money coming from the federal government, and Florida and Alabama said, we're going to give it to individual landowners and let them do the elimination. But Georgia said, we're going to keep it within the Department of Forestry. And as a result, they go back and make sure that it gets gone. And our hogan grass problem is much less than Florida and Alabama's. Okay. Tall fescue, giant reed, Nepalese brown top, Chinese silver grass, torpedo grass, Basie's grass, Johnson grass. I don't even know most of those grasses. Forbs, garlic mustard. Karen and Yvonne and I camped for one of the Georgia Botanical Society pilgrimages. It was beautiful. I think it was called Black Mountain State Park when we were going to the Botanical Society pilgrimage a number of years ago. And right next to our tents, there was a big mass of garlic mustard. So we proceeded to remove garlic mustard during our free time from the pilgrimage. By the way, that is the highlight of my year. Georgia Botanical Society has a pilgrimage every year someplace different in the state of Georgia for 3 days. You're on field trips all day, Friday, all day Saturday, all day Sunday. And potluck dinner on Friday night and Saturday night, a catered dinner with speakers. It's like $30 or $25 or something. It's just amazing. It's coming up. It's the 6th, 7th, and 8th. The Native Plant Society in Florida has a big conference where you have field trips with a lot of the scientific research, so it costs hundreds and hundreds of dollars. Okay, shrubby Lespedeza, Chinese Lespedeza, tropical soda apple, purple loosestrife, and mullein. I'm not familiar with most of those either. So other problems with plant introductions are that they bring in insects and diseases. And so you've heard about the chestnut trees getting mostly wiped out. There's something called sudden oak death. The dogwoods all over the city of Thomasville are just dying by the many, many. And I'm sure it's partly from drought, but it's also that they're weakened by that disease. Hemlocks, I went to Joyce Kilmer Park in North Carolina with tulip trees in there. I measured tree by hugs, and I figured these were 5-hug trees. But all the hemlocks were dead, and that's true all throughout the mountains there. The newest disease, which is not listed on here, is one that's killing all the red bays, and it came in Savannah on on pallets, I think. And that insect gets in the red bays, and it carries a fungal disease, and it knocks out the big trees just immediately. We moved my mother-in-law up from Chiefland, Florida, and all the giant, big red bays were dead. And they hold on to their leaves. It's really weird. So you see these great big trees with brown leaves on them. The babies, a real small one may be all green, but by the time they get about this big, the ends of their branches have brown leaves, and they will never make a mature tree. I saw an aerial picture of the Everglades, and it was like 30% brown from this disease. It's called laurel wilt disease, and it also damages sassafras and spice bush trees, which are the host plant for spice bush swallowtail. But it also avocados, and on PBS I saw a piece one time about the avocados, and it was the same thing I'd seen with the red bays, avocado trees, which are massive. I had no idea, gigantic branches, and the leaves out on the far end of them would be green. So they're trying to do some research now on fungicides and breeding resistant trees. And they're invasive animals too. Wild hawks are one of the worst. They just destroy ecosystems like crazy, especially in the wetland. We're real worried about them for the trout lilies, because the trout lilies stop right at the floodplain. I mean, start right at the floodplain, and the hogs could do major damage. We've seen one there, but across the four-lane highway, there's a real bad problem. Armadillos, fire ants. We all hate fire ants. You've probably heard about the pot hogs eating everything in sight. The biodiversity in the Everglades is just from the pot hogs. And I actually heard on the radio this morning that somebody's introducing a bill in the state of Florida to put some numbers of hundreds of thousands of dollars to pay people to go out and try to kill the python. They're real hard to find them. And then this is an unpopular statement, but another inconvenient truth. Billions of wildlife of all kinds are killed by domestic cats each year. Please keep your cats indoors, and it's healthier for them too. It's just how it is. The University of Georgia put cameras on well-fed domestic cats in the Athens area a few years ago, and they killed everything they found. You don't know it. They don't bring you all of it. They'll bring you some of it. My cat used to bring me a beautiful little velvet molds. But they killed everything. They killed every kind of life that they found. So let's get on to the more positive side of it again. This is a white oak that they planted in their yard, and this is a little friend of theirs. And so they took all these pictures watching her and the tree grow up. Isn't that a lovely thing to do, plant a tree with your baby grandchild and then watch them grow up? So here's the same white oak, and this is a new series in this year's slideshow. In 2014, on one day, he went out and counted all the caterpillars of the eggs on several trees, including this little white oak. 410 caterpillars of 19 species. So you see why he has all these wonderful birds in his yard. But, as I was saying in the last slide, that 10 acres was fields when they bought that property. And he's just covered it with natives, and now it's a wonderland of nature. And we often do that. Black cherry had 239 caterpillars of 14 species. Gallery of Bradford pear, one caterpillar, one species. Probably not eating the pear. It was a chance, so just crawl over there to visit. Burning bush, another invasive. Leaf skeletonizers, four caterpillars, one species. No support for walleye. So here's a summary. White oak, 233, black cherry, 53, burning bush, 2, gallery pear, Bradford pear, 1, basically none. So here's some beautiful Bradford pears. We all thought we were doing a wonderful thing planting them all over the place. And again, they said it wouldn't become invasive, but obviously they have. So which trees should we be sure to have in our landscapes? And this is a very new emphasis that he's making now. This is on your sheet, but I translated it into English. And so on the front, you'll see oaks support 534 species of butterflies and moths, black cherry and the other cherry laurel, choke cherry, and wall plum support 456 species, willow 455, etc. So this is the next number of slides, is that you want to focus on the ones that support the most. And he doesn't, in the slideshow, mention, but on the back, you'll see the best herbaceous plants and how many they support. Goldenrod, aster, sunflower, joe pie, weed bug, sedges, native honeysuckle, etc. So if you plant something over here instead of something over here, you're not doing near as much, even though these are natives. You're not doing near as much for wildlife as if you plant some of this. And that's why I only put the top ones in there. This is a new website of the National Wildlife Federation called Native Plant Ponder. It's for the whole country, and I went to it the other day, and you put in your zip code, and I didn't find it real helpful because I was asking, did a certain tree exist in our county? I mean, that's how the website went. And personally, I'm gonna plant a native plant if it's, you know, a few counties over. I'm not gonna be dedicated to it. I'm gonna plant ones in my county. But the Ecoscapes is the same type of help, where you can go online and you can say, I have a low place that stays moist. You know, what should I plant in that area that's native to Georgia? I have a hot place with sandy soil, what should I plant in that? And there are other sources online too. It, you know, it's amazing what you can find online these days. So I really highly recommend you go to the Ecoscapes booth right out here on the right and get some of the literature and, you know, use the website. Plants that serve as key sources of food are called foraging hubs. And this is a white oak, just like the one with the little girl. So it's like airports are hubs. And so he's calling the willow, the cherry, the oak, the pine, and the, are the most important plants that you possibly can plant. So why would the animals hunt on the oaks, cherries, and willows and pines? Because that's where the food is. And so that's what we need to provide is those plants for their food. 5% of the available native plant genera, the foraging hub, supports 73% of the available caterpillar species. So you could build a landscape using 95% of the available native plant genera and still support only 27% of the available Lepidoptera, the butterflies and moths. So to summarize that, if you plant the plants at the tops of the list, you're going to support up to 70% of caterpillars. But if you plant the ones at the bottoms of the list, you're only going to support 20 or 30% at most. Oaks support 557 species of caterpillars. Ginkgo, 4 species of caterpillars. I laughed when I came in the door here because there's artificial ginkgos in the lobby. And I thought, well, they're just like the live ones. They don't support any Native prunus, which is the cherries and the plums, 456 species of caterpillars. And this, I guess, across the whole United States. I'm not really sure where these figures came from. This beautiful tree supports no caterpillars. This beautiful plant supports 2 species. Viburnums, which are lovely plants. I highly recommend viburnums. Make the flowers in the spring and the berries in the fall. And they support 103 species of caterpillars as well. So this is a very similar plant that he has in his yard, and you can buy it now in the nursery trade, probably because of his book. It's called alternate leaf dogwood, but I asked him, and it is more commonly further north than us, and so it needs a cooler environment. I planted one in the shade and in my son's house. But I asked him what's equivalent from the south, and he said the arrowwood viburnum, which we just saw a picture of a minute ago. So, like I said, in the spring with flowers for the adult Lepidoptera, and in the winter the berries. And this is this plant outside his window. And this is about a third of the pictures that he has, the pictures that he's taken out that window. That's the cedar waxwing that the Nandinas killed. And butterflies too. So think about your house and what kind of plants you have around it. If all you have is non-natives, it's like you put out empty bird feeders all over your yard for the birds. But if you plant natives, it's like you filled it up with full bird feeders. We're not fooling the birds when we fail to plant foraging hubs. If you want to make a difference, you don't have to save biodiversity for a living, like our botanist friends do, but you do have to save it where you live if you want to make a difference, and you can make a difference. The organisms in most of our landscape ecosystems have no evolutionary history together. They've not had time to develop the specialized relationships that took tens of thousands of years. Species disappear from novel ecosystems. So we take a typical new development and we cut down all the trees and plant back exotics, and all the life that used to live there is gone. How many species do we need? All of them. That's a category of one of the spice bush swallowtails, and those are fake eyes. Try to scare the predators off. Probably work pretty well. Biodiversity equals ecosystem services. We've degraded 60% of the Earth's ecosystem services. Like this. This was the fuller. We degraded it down like that. This is the greatest ecosystem change since an asteroid hit the planet 60 million years ago, leading to the extinction of the dinosaurs. And this is human caused, partly by climate change as well. Biodiversity losses are a clear signal that humanity's life support systems are failing. Biodiversity runs the ecosystems on which we depend and the services they provide. The more diverse an ecosystem is, the more services it will provide. With the increase in human population, we need more ecosystem services, not fewer. As we kill off biodiversity, we get fewer services. Why not let our natural areas make the ecosystem services we need? Kind of the same question we asked earlier. I flew over the United States from Portland to Atlanta a few years ago, and there was just no darkness. It was really horrifying to me. It was across the northern part of the United States. You can see we got a little bit of undeveloped land in the Okefenokee. We have usurped so much of the natural world that we now need to build functioning ecosystems at home. That last slide said. We must raise the bar for what we ask our landscapes to do. We've been talking the whole time about supporting life. Sequestering carbon. The plants take in the carbon dioxide and keep the carbon in their bodies and in their roots. And that cuts down on the carbon dioxide in the environment. Clean and manage water. If you have a natural area and there's big rain, a lot of it soaks into the ground and gets purified by the natural systems under the ground. But if you have a house and you have a rain garden and it just goes off your driveway and off your lawn and everything, and it picks up the oil and everything like that, so it definitely cleans the water. And manage water too. The flooding in New Orleans wouldn't have been there so bad in Katrina if they had destroyed a lot of the wetlands south of there. The natural landscapes enrich the soil and support the pollinators. 80% of all plants and 90% of all flowering plants are pollinated by animals. So losing our pollinators is not an option. It's 40% of our food plants. And it's not just about the European honeybee, which there's been a lot of publicity about because that means a lot of money to people. But when they've done research on what pollinates our crops, they found that a lot of the natives also are pollinating. I heard a talk in Moultrie one time at the Georgia Conservancy meeting there that they found out that they were killing the primary pollinator for cotton for decades by pesticiding the cotton, and it was a tiny little wasp, and so now they've developed pesticides that don't kill that wasp. We're not talking about good land stewardship, we're talking about essential land stewardship. So, you know, this presentation is somewhat dark, but we really need to realize that this is really and he's gotten stronger and stronger on this in the past years. If your property does not generate all the ecosystem services you need, you will have to borrow services from someplace else. Prepared. So our past criteria for choosing plants for our landscapes has been mostly decorative value. And, you know, again, if you were an early settler and then you were moving into town and then when we made the suburbs, you know, you wanted to decorate your yard and make it pretty, and things became popular like clothes fashions and that kind of thing. And everybody planted the Artesia and the Indian and the Mimosa and the Gustrum and everything. And, you know, we just didn't know any different. We didn't know any better. We didn't know that it would become a problem. And we took we took biodiversity for granted because with lower populations, you know, there was a lot more, there were a lot more natural areas, but now we're really reaching a critical point of where we need to really pay attention to this, and all of us probably need to do this. So, the future criteria for choosing plants is what we've been talking about, the food web value, the watershed value, the carbon sequestration, the soil restoration, the weather moderation, the pollinator services, but also wildlife appreciation and mental health. There's been a lot of research lately. I was asked to speak on this subject at Thomas University recently, and I did some research. And it was very impressive how much research they're doing now on the effects of natural areas on people's lives. Even 15 minutes in a native landscape decreases blood pressure, restores attention span, reduces hyperactivity, decreases stress and depression, and improves the immune system. And they've done a lot of research in big cities where you have areas where there are no trees at all, and people go walking in that neighborhood versus walking in the neighborhood, you know, with some parks and some natural areas. And people in big cities who have some natural surroundings are less violent in general, and there's less domestic violence. This is a book that came out a few years ago, Last Child in the Woods, Saving Our Children from Nature Deficit Disorder. Our kids are doing this instead of this. Our kids have nature deficit disorder because we have a deficit in nature. But there's no better way to expose children to nature than to bring nature home to the children. And they're clueless. They're really clueless. My last job was working in the school system in the kindergarten class. And at recess, we'd go out and I'd start pointing out the wildlife to the kids. And we saw some real special birds coming in with nesting material. But even the red cardinals, they had never noticed before. A big percentage of the kids had never noticed a red cardinal. It just was shocking to me. So if this is a pretty typical suburban house, hopefully some of the trees are native, probably the shrubs are not. And if that person wants to make a difference, then they can change their yard like this. Replace any of the non-native that they want to with native, and plant more native trees and more native shrubs. And you want to have layers, just like a forest does. So you want canopy trees, you want smaller understory trees, you want shrubs, you want ground cover, and you also want mulch. Mulch is really, really important for the spiders and some of the insect larvae. So instead of designing flower beds, all the L's messed up, didn't they? In a sea of lawn, design the lawn for walking and play and plant the rest with natives. So, you, like in that last slide, you have plenty of room to walk and to play, but you don't have most of the lawn. What does a biodiversity-friendly neighborhood look like? Corridors are very, very important. And when I bought I bought two houses on the same block. And I chose it because it has a creek in the middle, and none of the neighbors had cut down the trees on the creek except my next door neighbor. And I asked him, could I plant natives on the creek side? And he said yes. And so now it is a beautiful natural area too. You can
hold the mic closer.
Give me a few minutes. Hold close. To share our lives with wildlife, we need to protect remaining natural areas. Create corridors connecting the natural areas in our yards, neighborhoods, roadsides, and power corridors, and reduce the area now lawn. The easiest way to do that is with cardboard. You put cardboard down on lawn, and then you put potash or some kind of mulch on top of that. The earthworms love it. They go to eat that, and it's gone. Cardboard's gone, and you can even leave the plastic on. And begin the transition from alien ornamentals to native ornamentals. We can save biodiversity and prevent mass extinctions if we redesign our city, suburbs, parks, farms, roadsides, and power corridors so that other species can share those species with us. Let's rebuild nature's relationships. And that I want to point out the roadsides and the power corridors are very important. Being seen is very, very important because the creatures need the corridors to get from one place to the other. So I'll just go through these quickly. If we replaced our half of the lawn, it would be as much as all of these parks. Here's an entrance to a zoo and how they changed it.
about how you feel when you're looking at them. When I spoke to the fellow garden club, the ladies here from that one, they said, oh, that looks just like Miss So-and-so's yard. That was an elderly lady. Really brilliant. So you add surprise, anticipation, and entertainment to your yard, and so it's a beautiful thing. And you see all kinds of creatures you didn't know existed. That's a caterpillar that actually plucks the pebbles off of the flower and puts them on its back.
Wow.
And you just get to see all these wonderful things. If you really am that was the state butterfly of Georgia. You have to be 100% native. The priorities are to remove the invasives first, reduce the area of known lawn, plant natives, and then consider replacing any unwanted exotics that you have. And it's up to you what you keep. The last presentation, the lady said that she had a nectar plant that the pollinators loved, and it was a plant that her grandmother loved. And I said, well, that's a perfectly wonderful reason to keep a non. Okay, so this is what he thinks of non-native plant yard, and especially Craig Gordon. It's the same as just having a bunch of statues. No ecosystem. So. And this is a series on how the neighborhoods in South Florida accidentally saved the tower butterfly, because this is their first plant, and that became a popular plant, and they thought it was extinct, and came back. Residential landscapes are such a powerful conservation tool. The residents of Florida were able to restore the populations without even trying. Okay, so this is the end. How do you know if you succeeded? We have holistic gardens. You see your plants, your native plants being eaten. It's good. And you have lots of different things, like the fireflies come back. But the most important thing is, do you see bird reproduction in New York? Nature is resilient and forgiving. We still have a chance to make a difference. His 10 acres were fields when he purchased them. It's not been 100 years ago. It's 10 acres originally. Now there's 54 species of breeding birds. We can do it too. I thought I'd left her off on my handout, but I had on the handout you'll see a lot of native nursery sources and other things of interest on that. And if you would like me to give this presentation to any of your garden clubs or any other groups, I'd be happy to do it. Or to a foster for that's it. On the list, I couldn't cause you I looked at my boys, I saw them, and she was so good. Yeah. The grand, grand.